Verily, all praise is due to Allah. We seek His help, we seek His aid, we seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil within our own souls. Whosoever Allah guides, there is no one to lead astray. Whosoever Allah leads astray, there is no one to guide upright. I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship and truth except Allah alone. He has no partners and all domains is His. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is His messenger and seal of all the prophet. O you who believe, fear Allah as He should be feared and do not die except as Muslimun. O mankind, fear your Lord who created you from a single soul, Adam. And from him, He created His mates, Eve. And from them both, He created countless generations of men and women spread on the earth. And fear Allah through whom you demand your mutual rights. And do not cut the womb that bores you, surely Allah is ever and all watcher over you. O mankind, fear your Lord and always speak the truth. He will guide you to do good deeds and He will forgive you your bad deeds. And whoever obey Allah and His messenger has achieved a great amount of success. Fa'inu khairu hadith kitab Allah. Verily the best speech is the book of Allah. Fa'inu hadi hadu Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the best guidance is that of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Wa sharul umul mudathatuha. And the worst of affairs is to introduce newly matters into the religion of Islam. Wa kula bid'atin dalala. And each innovation leads astray. Wa kula dalala into nar. And each going astray is in the hellfire. Every single day, we as human beings, we wake up with a schedule or some plans of what we're going to do for that day. Many of us, we would plan for today a week in advance. Many of us, we plan for our whole week starting with Monday. I'm going to do this on Tuesday. I'm going to go here on Wednesday. Many of us, we wake up in the morning, we go to work. Some of us go to the gym to exercise. Some people wake up just to walk their dogs in the morning. Some people wake up to make salat, to pray to Allah. But even though everybody from different parts of the world, everybody waking up doing something that day, we all heading towards the same direction. We all heading to the final destination. And before we get to that final destination, we all have to make a stop. And this stop that I'm talking about is not to fuel up, to put more petrol in the car. This stop is called the grave. Every single one of us on this face of the earth, we have a grave that's waiting for us. And after the grave, we have another destination, which is the final destination for every human being, no matter what religion they come from, no matter what background they come from. That final destination is either the hellfire forever or heaven forever. But just like every destination, even in this dunya, you have directions. If somebody give me an address, of course I want to take directions so that I can reach that destination in an easy, smooth way. Some of us, we don't want directions. We want to go take this destination according to what we think, and we end up going the wrong way for hours before we get to a destination and figure that we was wrong all along. Alhamdulillah, all praise due to Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, that even the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day of judgment day, we have directions. And Allah sent down directions over 1400 years ago in the book called the Quran, and the final messenger called the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this direction is a direction not only to teach us how to get to Yawm al-Qiyamah, but it's also a direction that teaches us to stay away from doing them acts that are called us to the hellfire. From the mercy of Allah, He sent us this last Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that this is a religion that teaches us everything. It's a way of life. And Allah says in the Quran that I did not create mankind a jinn only to worship me. Every single person in this room, Allah created us so that we can worship Him alone. He didn't create us so that we can become gangsters or thugs. He didn't create us so that we can get music careers and run around the stage dancing all day. Allah created us for one purpose. Every single thing on this face of the earth has a purpose. Whether we see it or not, everything has a purpose. The oxygen has a purpose. The thumb on your hand, if we didn't have a thumb, we won't even be able to grip anything. The hair that's in your nostrils, it has a purpose from keeping bacteria, particles of dust from entering into your nose. The eyelashes, it has a purpose to keep particles of dust and other bacteria from going in the eyes. So we have to use our common sense and ask ourselves, what is our purpose? Do we believe that we can just come on this earth in this world, do whatever we want to do? Live the life, whatever we want to do, and when we dead, we go to sleep, that's it. Well, I was one of them people that I used to believe that in a way. I used to kind of believe that I can do whatever I want because God, Allah, this is what my thinking was, that I'm from the ghetto. So if I pull out a gun and shoot somebody, Allah, he knows my situation. If I use drugs, Allah know my situation. This was my mentality. I used to believe that I can live life, do whatever I want to do. When I face God on Day of Judgment, I can say, well, you put me in the ghetto. I seen drugs. I had this stuff around me. When I got into the music industry, I got into the music industry to leave a life that I was running from in America. Most of the people in my neighborhood, my brothers and my cousins, they was drug dealers. My life at a very young age, when I was 13 years old, I went outside to follow them in their footsteps, and I went and I tried to sell drugs. The first day that I went outside to sell drugs, I got arrested by the police. They locked me up, and I told myself, let me figure another way to make a hustle. So I turned to writing music. I had a childhood friend by the name of Yafeo, and he was the half-brother of a person by the name of Tupac Shakur. They happened to come to New York City. I met Tupac Shakur, and he decided to put me in a rap group, and that rap group became known as the Outlaws. I appeared on over 40 million record sales worldwide. When I was with Tupac, I remember before he came to Death Row Records, he used to always speak about death. He had songs that used to call Death Around the Corner. Even though he was the biggest selling rap artist, he wasn't happy. It's times that we would be in the living room with Tupac and he would be saying to me and the rest of the Outlaws, I wish that I could kill myself right now. I want to go in the garage, turn the car on, and just die. But when Tupac went to Death Row Records, he put this record out and he started to make a lot of money. And I remember this conversation, man, because this conversation stuck to my head. We were sitting in the living room of Tupac and he said, remember how I used to always speak about death? He said, but for some reason, now that I just made all this money, he just bought him a house in Malibu, California. Literally, the beach was our backyard. We would sit in his living room and we'd look in the backyard, we would see the ocean. He had a Rolls Royce parked in the driveway. And he said, I remember I used to want to die. But now that I have this money, I have this house, I have this fame, I have this car, I want to live so that I can enjoy my success. A few months later, Tupac was in Las Vegas, driving in the car with Suge Knight. Tupac got into a fight with an individual. Even though he's a rapper that sold over 60 million records worldwide, he got into a fight with an individual. Everybody departed, went their separate ways. A couple hours later, Tupac driving in the car, he might have felt that something was gonna happen. He told his fiance, he told the other female members of his family. He said, I don't want y'all following me today. I want y'all to stay at the hotel just in case these people come back to do something. Even though they had bodyguards. Death Row Records had bodyguards that was ex-policemen walking around with loaded guns. But for some reason, every member of the bodyguard, the Qadr of Allah, they left their guns in the hotel that day. A car pulled up on the side of Tupac and Suge Knight. They opened fire. They shot Tupac 13 times. When I got the phone call that Tupac got shot, it was very strange. Because a couple hours before, Tupac called me. And an Outlaw member answered the phone and he said, I want to speak to Napoleon. He was very excited to tell me that he just beat somebody up. So I said, well, I'll wait for the next call, the Tupac. I want to speak to him. I want to know what happened. I get back to the house, Young Noble from the Outlaws. I said, did Tupac call? He ran to the gate to let me in. He said, no, but somebody else called. Pac just got shot. The first thing that came to my mind as well, I didn't believe that Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, had control over the life at this time. I believe it depends on how much strong of a person you are that you can survive weapons. Because a few years before this, somebody pulled out a gun on Tupac in the elevator. They shot him 5 times. He got shot twice in the head. And he survived the shooting. So I used to believe if you a gangster enough, you can survive shootings. I had many friends in my neighborhood got shot 10 times, 13 times. Well, lie to this day, they walking around. But I didn't understand that this was because it wasn't a time to die. So I said, Tupac, he's going to make it out of the hospital. We're going to do more records talking about our enemies and the people that shot him. And that's it, halas. When I went to Las Vegas, I asked Suge Knight. I said, what's up, Suge? What happened to Pac? Suge explained to us. We said, how was Pac acting when he first got shot? Because at this time, Pac was in a coma. I haven't seen him yet lying in the hospital bed, but I heard that he was in a coma. Suge Knight said that when the people pulled up, Tupac tried to jump in the back seat. And he said that's when he got shot the most. He said when we got to the elevator, Tupac was a guy that always liked to joke. He started to joke with Suge Knight. He had a joke that he used to always call Suge Knight Sweaty Head. Because he was a big guy that always sweat a lot. He was a 6'7" guy, 365 pounds, Suge Knight, and he sweat a lot. So Pac called him Sweaty Head. He said, all I know, we was in the back seat of the ambulance, and Tupac was joking with me. Then he took a deep breath. He breathed in and he exhaled, and he said, Suge, I don't think I'm going to make it this time. 6 days later, he died in the hospital. He was only 25 years old. Once the death of Tupac occurred, that was the first time that it dwelled on me that we're not in control over our lives or when we're going to die. The first time in my life, I said this was an individual who was chasing after death. As soon as he started to make this money so that he can enjoy this life in this world, a few months later, Allah took his soul. That was the first time in my life that I literally said, we don't even know when we're going to die. My whole life I seen death. When I was 3 years old, I witnessed my mother and father get murdered in front of me. Brothers, can y'all move up to let the other brothers come in, inshallah? My whole life I seen death. So I was an individual. I never was afraid of death because I knew that this is going to happen to me, but I thought that I had control over it. My mother and father got murdered in front of me when I was 3. During the murder of my mother and father, a bullet shot me in my foot. I grew up in a neighborhood where my brother got shot, friends got shot. But this was the first time that somebody that was close to me that I lived with. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you don't know an individual until you live with him, travel with him, and do business with him. I lived with this individual. I traveled with him and I did business with him, and he was a brother to me. So when I saw him in the hospital bed, I was able to look death in his eyes. I said, this is real. What I'm going to do with my life? Now, if Tupac died, and he didn't know it was coming, I started to say, man, this got to happen to me. But at this time of my life, I started to get worried because I wanted to know what's going to happen to me when I'm dead. I had no religion, but I believed in God. I believed that we definitely going to face God in the next life. And at this time, I was curious of what was happening to Tupac. Every day I would wake up and I would say, I wonder where my homie is at. Can you imagine living with an individual, the same house? His room was right here, my room was right here. Now to wake up, he gone every single day to say, I wonder where he's at. I wonder what's going on with him. So at this time of my life, I continue to move on and do music. Tupac died in September. I went to New Jersey in October. I got arrested in New Jersey and I told myself, once I get out of the jail cell, whatever, it was only a week, it wasn't nothing big. I told myself, jail is not for me. I'm going to go back and I'm going to pursue my career in the music industry. Gaddafi, Yafeyo, he was a member of the Outlaws and he was the person that introduced me to Tupac. I told Gaddafi, I said, let's get out of Jersey. New Jersey is a very horrible place. Let's get out of New Jersey. Let's continue to pursue our career in the music industry. Gaddafi said, no, I want to stay in New Jersey. You go and I'll meet you in a few months. I introduced Gaddafi to a little cousin of mine. I had a little cousin. He was known to have a rep. He always carried a gun. And he was known to use that gun. I figure if he hang out with Gaddafi, Gaddafi is in good hands. Tupac died in September. I left New Jersey in October. I get a phone call in November that Gaddafi just got shot. And when I asked the person on the other side of the phone who shot Gaddafi, they said Napoleon, it was your little cousin. So for me, I couldn't imagine 2 months in a row, 3 months at a time, man. 2 months ain't go past and now another member of the group that I live with got shot. I called my little cousin, of course he denied it because he was afraid. 3 days later, Gaddafi died. He was only 17 years old. At this time of my life, I started to say, well, now it's definitely going to happen. I lost my grandmother a few months ago. Within that same year, my oldest brother from the same father committed suicide. I lost Tupac. I lost Gaddafi. I said, man, I'm losing my mind. I started to get drunk and high on drugs every single day. I didn't know how to cope with the deaths around me. But at the same time, we put out an album. And I started to make a lot of money from this record. We sold 2 million records worldwide. And I said, well, matter of fact, I would get happy because now I got a pocket. I got a bank full of money. Every 6 months, I was cashing checks for 180,000, 75,000, 80,000. Man, I was cashing these checks. Whatever I wanted on this dunya, I was able to go get it. If I wanted a brand new house, I was able to go get it. Every time a brand new car would come out, I was able to go get it. I used to tell myself, man, this is the ultimate happiness. This is what's going to make me happy. Maybe this is why I was depressed all my life. But every single day I went to sleep in that brand new house, believe it or not, I was depressed. Every single day I drove in that brand new car, $80,000 car, I was depressed. I wasn't happy. And I would tell myself, if the money is not making me happy, because some people, unfortunately, they believe the only way they're going to cure their problems is through money. Some people, unfortunately, they think the only way they're going to get happy is that they have to have $1 million in their bank. If that was the truth, how come you have billionaires committing suicide? If that was the truth, how come you have millionaires murdering their own selves every single day? I know some personally. Before I got out of the music industry, I did an album with a guy named Johnny J. He produced over 100 million records worldwide. He produced most of all the songs of Tupac. He produced songs with the Jackson 5, Michael Jackson family, everybody. He produced these records. I get a phone call about 7-8 months ago from his wife. She was crying hysterically. She said, Johnny J just committed suicide. He just committed suicide. Not only did he take his life, he did it in one of the harshest ways. He got locked up from getting drunk. He wasn't happy, so he used to drink alcohol every single day. When he got locked up in a prison, he decided that one day, I'm going to take my life. He jumped off of one of the tiers, and he committed suicide that way. He had a house on 5 acres of land. He had $1 million in the bank account. He had a pool in his backyard that shape of a heart. He had everything you can imagine in his dunya, but he didn't have any tranquility in his heart. He didn't have tranquility in his heart. So when I got myself in that same position, I was really surprised and shocked that I have money, but I'm not happy. I basically told myself the television lied to me. They made it seem when you see a person with a big house and a nice car, they're the happiest people on earth. So at this particular time of my life, I started to get really high and intoxicated on drugs. I said that I have to pretend. I was in denial. I had to escape this life. I didn't want to really face the reality that I wasn't happy. So every single day I would get drunk. This was my life. I would wake up sober. I would think of something that I did last night that was crazy, and I would go get drunk again so that I could forget about it. This was my life. It was a cycle. It's people that live that same life to this day. And one day with that same attitude, I got into a fight with my little brother, and I was very aggressive. This is my same little brother that I took from the hood that brought him to California with me. This was my little brother. He was only 6 months old when my mother and father got murdered. But I was very angry and I fought my little brother and I sent him to the hospital where he had to get staples in his head. And there happened to be a Muslim in that parking lot that day, alhamdulillah. And he came to me and he calmed me down and he spoke to me. We exchanged phone numbers and he said, I got a place that I want you to visit. Because there's some non-Muslims here today. And they came here and they visit the mosque. This is a decree of God that he brought you here this day. So when I finally, after phone calls, I finally went to visit the mosque. I've never been in a mosque in my life. I said, let me see what this guy is talking about. And when I walked into the mosque, I seen a sense of brotherhood that I don't see in the hood. I didn't see in the streets. I seen grown men hugging each other, shaking each other's hands. They was very respectful. I didn't see these people in the streets. I didn't see none of this in my life. Eventually, this brother, he gave me literature of the religion of Islam. Before that, I used to say, man, I'll never be a Muslim. Because the people that killed my mother and father was from a group of people called the Nation of Islam in America. And all my life I thought that the Nation of Islam and the religion of Islam was the same religion. So when he gave me the English translation of the Quran, and he gave me literature of the religion of Islam, I took it home and I started to read this book. And wallahi, I swear to God, when I started to read that book, even though it was in an English translation, I said, man, there is no way on the face of the earth that these can be the words of a man. There is no way on the face of the earth that a man can even think of these words or put these words together this way. I used to wonder why everybody around me is dying. Allah says in the Quran, every single soul shall taste death. When I read that verse, I knew that this was true because people around me was dying left and right. I used to wonder how come I have to get drunk off alcohol to feel good, but then 15 minutes or the next day when I'm sober, I'm depressed again. Allah says in the Quran, He said, truly the hearts find tranquility in the remembrance of Allah. Nothing on this world can make you happy. Nothing gonna bring tranquility in your life unless you know why you was created. All my life, everything that I was looking for was in that book, that Quran. Allah was letting me know in that book that He was the creator of the heavens and the earth and He deserved to be worshipped alone. I grew up in a Christian household. My grandmother used to tell me that Jesus is the Son of God and you have to pray to Jesus to get to God, and I never understood that. I never understood that. I used to read the Bible and Jesus is saying the Bible. In the book of Matthew, they asked Jesus. The disciples said, oh my Lord. No, they said, oh Master, oh Great One, how do we achieve eternal life? Jesus said, first of all, there's no one great but the one who's in heaven above us. And He said, the way you achieve eternal life, meaning the way you go to heaven forever, is stick to the commandments. The first commandment is, O children of Israel, I am your Lord. Do not worship other gods besides me. So when I used to read this in the Bible, I used to wonder why my grandmother telling me I have to pray to Jesus. In the Bible, in the Jesus, when He was on a so-called cross, because as Muslims, we don't believe He was on a cross. But even in the Bible, in the Christian book, when they said He was on the cross, they said that He said, Eli, Eli, my Lord, why have you forsaken me? I used to ask myself when my grandmother told me to worship Him. In the Bible, He's saying, my Lord, how can He be God when He's calling to God? I was very confused. When I read the Quran, it was very clear. Allah, for example, every single day, look at the things that Allah bring into existence. Every single second, Allah's taking a soul or He's taking the life of something. Every second, Allah's bringing something into being, something into existence. For example, it's snowing here in Denmark. It's 100 and something degrees in Saudi Arabia. It's raining in New York City. It's 80 something degrees where I live in California. They blame this on global warming, but none of this happened without the permission of Allah. Everything that happens on the face of the earth that we don't even know about is happening by the permission of Allah. You got creatures in the ocean that we don't even know exist, but Allah is feeding them. Allah is providing for them. Every single one of us in this room, I have a different thought. Allah knows what's in our mind. This is amazing, man. Allah is glorified for what the partners they set up to Allah. This is why Allah deserves to be worshipped alone. Because every other God that the people worship besides Allah, they cannot do none of this. Mankind cannot do none of this. We are so weak that Allah says in the Quran that even if a fly take a piece of paper away from us and fly to the sky, we can't even take the paper back. This is how weak we are. And we arrogant. And we don't want to worship our Lord. We don't want to worship our Lord. Every single day we wake up out of our bed, it's only from the mercy of Allah that He put our soul back in our body and gave us another day. Perhaps we will return back to Allah. Look what happened to the people in Haiti. May Allah guide them to Islam. This was a country, man, that they believe in doing shirk, associating partners with Allah. They believe in calling on the shayateen to help them. This is a known fact. This is something in their religion. The state religion of Haiti is voodoo. They called on the devils. I grew up with Haitian. This is a fact. Haiti and Dominican Republic is almost the same country. Dominican Republic, they have different religion. They have Muslims there. They had other religions, but they don't practice voodoo. How come a few miles away, a few miles later in Haiti where they practice voodoo, an earthquake came, 230,000 people died. Some people say this Mother Nature. A'udhu billah, this is from Allah. Allah says in the Quran, the day that the earth was shaken with its final shaking, Yawmul Qiyamah. The earth do not shake without the permission of Allah. The scholars of Islam say this is the anger of Allah. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, one of the Muslim scholars in the past, when it was an earthquake in Medina, and the people came and told him it was an earthquake, he didn't run around and say, let's all come together and let's join hands and start humming. The first thing he said is, we need to make tawbah of Allah. When we hear of disasters like that, even though we might be in America or in Denmark, we shouldn't feel secure from the punishment of Allah. Because we commit sins here too. We should go back and say, let's make tawbah. So it's very important that brothers, we have to realize that we created for a purpose. Everything has a purpose. What is our purpose in life? Do we want to wait till Yawmul Qiyamah when we face Allah? And Allah said that you've seen Muslims all your life. Or that you was a Muslim all your life, but you didn't even want to make Salat. You was a Muslim. You was born a Muslim. You have Muslim parents, Muslim father. You come from Somalia. You come from Arabia. You come from Pakistan. You come from Africa. But as soon you move to the land of the non-Muslims, all of a sudden now you want to behave like the Kufar. Now all of a sudden you say, don't call me Muhammad, call me Mo. Now all of a sudden you want to sag your pants. Now all of a sudden you're a gangster. Now you don't even want to speak the Arabic language. You ashamed to speak the language of the Quran. You got Muslims ashamed to speak the Arabic language living in the West because they're afraid what the Kufar are going to do to them or the Kufar are going to laugh at us. They don't want to look like a Muslim. They don't want to look like a Muslim. They don't want to dress like the Sahabas or the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam because they're ashamed. They're ashamed to follow the religion of the Prophets. How can we let a disease get in our heart that bad that we're ashamed to follow the religion of all the Prophets from Adam, Jacob, David, Solomon, Moses, Abraham, John the Baptist, Jesus alayhi salam, and the last prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the prophets. These people follow the religion of Islam. Are we ashamed? How do you feel facing Allah on Yawmul Qiyamah? And you tell Allah, when Allah asks you, what did you do with your life? You say, well, I was from this gang. And I used to go to the other neighborhood and we used to fight other Muslim gangs. A'udhu billah. You got Muslims, wallahi, living in Danish countries, the biggest criminals. Allah says in the Quran that He raised us as the best of mankind. How can we live in a non-Muslim country and they afraid to walk down the street because they think that our Muslim youth gonna snatch their purse? This is disgusting. How do we feel like living in a non-Muslim country and we the drug dealers? And Allah's our Razak, He's our provider. Why do we have to sell drugs when we know that Allah will provide for us? This is one of His names and attributes. The provision was written down for us when we was in the wombs of our mother. How can you have Muslims killing other Muslims? How do you have Muslims killing each other in gangs? How do you feel getting raised up in front of Allah and say, I killed this Muslim brother because he was from another neighborhood? Do this make sense? When you have people in America, wallahi, I know brothers, alhamdulillah, wallahi, I know them personally. Personally, they was the biggest criminals in the neighborhood. I know brothers, before they accept the religion of Islam, they was hitmen. I know brothers, wallahi, man, that before they became Muslim, if I had a problem with an individual, that individual might disappear. I had family members like that. As soon as they accepted religion of Islam, you would never believe that they lived that life. Because the religion of Islam calls to all upright morals. If you practice the religion of Islam, it will call you away from oppressing other people. If you practice the religion of Islam and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it will give you good manners. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I came to perfect the manners of mankind. The Prophet said he came to perfect the manners of mankind. But look at the Muslim youth, look at us. We are far away from the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the person we look up to, not 50 Cent. You got Muslims, man, they know everything about David Beckham, everything about Tupac, everything about 50 Cent. But if you ask them about a Sahaba, they don't know nothing. You got Muslims, they say, we love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, never even read the biography of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What happened to us that we got into that state? And then we blame the Jews, we blame the Christians. We should blame ourselves. Allah says in the Quran, whatever evil befalls you is from what your own hands put forth. Whatever evil happened to the Muslim countries or the Muslim himself is because of our sins. We should start blaming ourselves. Most of us, unfortunately, man, may Allah guide us and make us better because we all in trouble, myself too. I might be here speaking to y'all, but I'm no different than y'all. I'm trying to get closer to Allah. I might have a thobe in a beard, but I know myself. I can't fool. You could come up to me and say, mashallah, all day. I know myself. I know I'm a sinner. I can't sit here and I can't front in front of Allah. I know that I need to get my life together. But the matter of fact, of the purpose of the fact is that we only have one chance to get it right. We only have one chance to get it right. We cannot wait till we're in the grave. And Allah put our soul back and we see the angels of death. We see them two angels with the, some narration said they would have black faces and blue eyes and they would have voices of thunder. And we see them question us in that grave. Now we're going to want to say, SubhanAllah, please take me back so I can make Fajr Salat. Please take me back so I can throw all the records away. Now that we see that it's the truth. Now that it's the haq, we're in the grave. You should be surprised how we're going to be afraid. Now we're going to wish that we would have never ever been hanging on that corner
talking about I'm a gangster. Now you wish that you your name was Muhammad. Now we in that grave wishing that we would have never said call me Mo. Now we wishing we would have never listened to one Outlaw Tupac record in our life. Now we wishing we would have never disrespect our mother and father. Now we wishing, oh Allah, take me back to that masjid that I live around the corner with. Please, it's too late though. It's too late for us. Now it's too late, it's over. We don't know when that's gonna happen to us. We don't know if that's tonight for any of us. May Allah give us all a righteous long life. Ameen. But we don't know when that's gonna come. That's the scary part of this. The scary part is that we know we're gonna die. Everybody in this room know they're gonna die. Scientists been trying for hundreds of years to figure a way to preserve life. This is how arrogant these people are. They think that they can freeze you and bring you back to life. They think that they think they can bring you back to life. One thing that they will never understand is the ruh, the soul. They can't even see that. How can you freeze the soul? You don't even know what it's made out. You don't even know what's inside of us. They got people right now and in different parts of the world in freezers for 1,000, for 400 years, for 200 years, for 100 years. They believe, they waiting that one day when they put the warmth on that body, it's going to jump. SubhanAllah, this is the mind state of the people that the world say are geniuses. These people is a genius. These people is the people that the people look up to. But they don't look up to the people that came to warn us of that great day. That day, man, where the earth going to shake with its final shaking. That day where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in a narration that the sun will come close to so many people and we will be sweating according to our sins. That day when the people going to be trying to go to that fountain to drink that water. When we're going to try to go to that fountain to drink with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. With the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Jazakallah khair. With the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if you drink from that fountain on that day of Yawmul Qiyamah, you will never go thirsty again. But guess what? All the Muslims are going to be running towards that day. All the Muslims are going to run towards that fountain. But it's going to be a group of Muslims who are going to run towards that fountain and the angels are going to swoop down and going to block them. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will go to the angels and say, what are you doing? These are my followers. The angels will say, no, messenger of Allah. You don't know what they did after you. You don't know the innovation that they did to this religion. You don't know when you left, they put the sunnah to the side. They thought the sunnah was only for the Arabs over 1400 years ago. They thought the sunnah mean you have to ride the camels. They made jokes of the sunnah, O messenger of Allah. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, would take them away. The sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is religion of Islam. The sunnah is what explains the religion of Islam. How are we turning our back from the sunnah? Most people, when you talk to them about the sunnah, they have an understanding that that means you have to drive camels. They believe that you have to drive camels. Allah says in the Quran, O Muhammad, we reveal the dhikr to you so that you can explain to the people his meanings. Allah said in that verse right there that it's another revelation explained in the Quran. That revelation is the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said it will come a time where an individual will be reclining on his sofa and somebody will bring a narration of mine, a hadith of mine. And this person would say, I don't want to hear the hadith, I'm only going by the Quran, this is from Allah. SubhanAllah, you hear this nowadays. You hear many Muslims say, I don't know what hadith is da'if, or I don't know what hadith is permissible or sahih, I'm only sticking to the Quran, this is from Allah. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, woe to that man, woe to that man, woe to that man. The Prophet said to eat the flesh of a donkey is haram. But do you find that in the Quran? No Muslim will eat the flesh of a donkey. Hamar, right? Hamar? No Muslim will eat hamar. It's not one verse in the Quran that says donkey meat is haram. We get that from the sunnah. So how do we think that we can live life not following the sunnah? Muslims, we pray five times a day. It's not nothing in the Quran that mentions how many rakahs we do. It's nothing in the Quran that mentions this. This is from the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is very important for us. Because the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in another narration that everybody from my ummah, every Muslim will go to heaven except for those that refuse. The Sahaba said, O Messenger of Allah, people will refuse to go to Jannah. He said, yes, those that follow my sunnah will go to Jannah. Those who don't will go to the fire. They won't go to Jannah. These are real words. We should take these words very serious, brothers. Sisters, these is real words. We have one time to get it right. Most of us, if not everybody, we love the messenger of Allah, right? We love Allah's messenger, right? Allah, he put us to a test. Allah says in the Quran, O Muhammad, you tell the people that if they love you, if they love me, to follow you, and then, and only then, I will love them back. Allah says in the Quran, clear as day, the only way he will love us is if we follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says in the Quran about following the Sahabas. He had verses in the Quran that we have to follow the Sahabas. So why do we take these gangster rappers as our role models? Why do you have the Muslim youth taking these gangster rappers as our role models? When you turn on the television, for example, and you see the videos of 50 Cent and Tupac, we only see 5 minutes of these life. They only see you 5 minutes of the life of these celebrities. And that 5 minutes, of course, they got to put the best life for the kids. They have to fool us. When they know that they only have 5 minutes to corrupt our brains and to corrupt the minds of the youth, these people are going to spend hundreds of millions of dollars of 5 minutes. Wallahi, rap videos cost millions of dollars. They will only show you 5 minutes. And they're going to make sure that that 5 minutes corrupt your mind to the best of their ability. They're going to make sure that that 5 minutes, when you look at them of that 5 minutes, you're going to wish that you have that life. They're going to make sure that when you look at that 5 minutes, you're going to say, man, Islam is boring. They look like they're having fun. Look at the woman in the videos. Look at the cars. Look at the jewelry. Look at their house. I want to have that life. I want to have that life. But you don't see when the cameras say cut. You don't see that when they go home and they put their jewelry off and they give it back to the store that they rented it from. You don't see that when the video's over, they give the keys back to the owner of that house. You don't see that when they go to the restaurants, they're afraid thinking that somebody's going to come blow their head off. You don't see that when they have to go to sleep, they have to take all type of medications just to go to sleep like Michael Jackson. He couldn't even sleep. He was saying Thriller all day, every day. He couldn't even sleep. This is serious. This is the life that our Muslim youth want. You want to give up a life of tranquility, a life that's calling to Jannah, for a life that's calling us to the hellfire? Nobody in their right mind would give up that life. Nobody in their right mind would think about it and say, wait a minute. If I do live a long life, I might only live to about 40 years old, 50 years old, 60 years old. But when I die, whatever my destination is, I'm going to live it forever. It's about time that these short lives, I get it together. Nobody in their right mind would think like that. Nobody with common sense would say, I'm going to the nightclub every single day. When I die, then I do Toba. If we just use our common sense, man, and know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said on Yom Kiyama that Allah is going to bring two rams. Two rams. One of them he's going to slaughter and say, these is for the people of Jannah, the people of paradise. I just slaughtered death. No more death. The other ram, he's going to slaughter it. It's going to be in the cause of death. He's going to say, this is the people of hellfire. You will see no more death. May Allah protect us from going to the hellfire. So it's very important, brothers. I don't want to talk too long to bore you guys. But I just want to remind you guys that this is a ni'mah from Allah that He guided us to the religion of Islam. And every blessing that a person have can be taken away from us. Every time you see something great, when the people take it for granted, it gets taken away from them. We cannot take the best blessing that someone can have in his life is the religion of Islam. This is better than having $1 billion in your bank account. One day we will see. One day on Yawmul Qiyamah, inshallah, we will say, Alhamdulillah, I was patient for this. Allah was the truth. Allah says in the Quran what He said was the truth. What His messenger said was the truth. We will say, Alhamdulillah, when a shaitan called me to commit that evil, I was patient for this, Alhamdulillah. We will be happy on a day. If we live according to the religion of Islam, it will be a day that we will be happy. This is why we have to realize and tell ourselves, man, let's just hold on. Life is short. Hold on for a little bit. We just have to be patient. We just have to say, man, let me be patient. Fight against our desires. And inshallah, at the end, we will see that one day we could be amongst the people of Jannah. That when they say you got houses, the real bling bling. One house brick is made out of gold. The other one is made out of silver. That you got rivers of honey, rivers of milk. That you can one day probably look at the Sahabas. You might can be able to walk up to Umar bin Khattab ready to handle and say, Mashallah, man, I love when you knock that hypocrite out or cut his neck off. We'd be able to say this to the Sahabas. You would be able to see the Abu Bakr. You would be able to see Bilal. Don't we want to be in that state? Don't we want to be amongst them companions? Don't we want to be in the life where we can see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Don't we want to be able to be walking and see a river of honey? So it's very important that we be patient in this life. This life is short, it's temporarily, the next life is forever.